Mr. Nault is a licensed civil and structural engineer with over 10 years of professional bridge engineering experience and works with engineers and owners to provide innovative design solutions using UHPC. So help me welcome Greg.
All right. Thank you guys for being here, and thanks to the NBPPC for having us. We're happy to talk about UHPC here. So just a quick overview for those that haven't heard of UHPC. It's kind of been a bit of a buzzword recently through a lot of conferences in the past few years. But what it basically is, it's a cement-based material, Portland cement-based material, but it's made with fine particles. And the idea behind it is you have a very tightly packed matrix, so when the product hydrates, you have very little pore structure within the element. So the durability becomes very high, and it's also reinforced with a bunch of microfibers that help control cracking. In addition, the fibers, if you provide enough percentage of fibers, it can provide strength to your system as well. So this is the definition FHWA came up with. It has a very low water to cement ratio, less than 0.25 and even less than 0.2 in a lot of cases, which really helps control shrinkage. A few properties just to highlight. Unit weight is typical with reinforced concrete. Modulus elasticity is about twice that. Compressive strength is quite high. We're generally above 21,000 PSI, really in the mid-20s to high 20s for compressive strength at 28 days. And we have some post-cracking tensile strength. So what that means is even without reinforcing bars, because of the fibers in this mix, when the material cracks, it can still carry tensile stress as part of your structural element. And lastly, the chloride ion penetrability, it's a way to measure the durability of the material, and we get a very, very low to negligible reading at 28 and 56 day testing. So I want to talk about durability real quick. There's a test that's been going on for over 20 years now up at a testing facility in Treat Island, Maine, owned and operated by the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. And what they do out here is they take a bunch of different concrete samples, they strap them to the raft that you see there, and they let the saltwater tides come in and completely saturate these samples. And you can see the water line on the piles in the background there. So the tides come in twice a day, of course. They completely submerge this in a saltwater solution, and it stays out there through the winter cycle and freezes and thaws and freezes and thaws. So they put some samples out there in 1996, and 10 years later, they went back out in 2006 and looked at the prisms that they had strapped to this raft. And the photo you see on the left there is the prisms 10 years later. And what we're really seeing is virtually no damage occurring to this product. Now, it's actually been 10 years since then, and they still have these samples. Unfortunately, the raft has disintegrated due to the harsh conditions, but they retain the samples and have done some lab testing to continue that process, and they're still getting the same results that they were seeing. So on the right, the lower left-hand corner of the graph, you can see kind of a humped line there. So what this is measuring is the percentage of chlorides that have migrated into the surface of the material. And what we see is right about 8 to 10 millimeters, the line hits back down to the 0% mark and kind of flatlines at that point. And the research that we're seeing is that the chlorides cannot penetrate this material past about 10 to 12 millimeters of depth. So this is really critical because of the low porosity of this material. There's what we call a discontinuous pore structure. There is porosity in the material, but they don't interconnect with one another. Ultimately, there's no pathway for water and salts and acids and contaminants to actually flow down inside the concrete and start the deterioration process. If I look at this graph here, this is taken from a Eurocode document, and it's specifying a minimum amount of cover over rebar. And if you look at their worst case situation in the worst exposure condition, think of a salt spray area or a salting of a bridge deck, the minimum cover requirement is 25 millimeters. So you do the math there, that's 1 inch of cover that you need to protect your rebar in even the worst environments that exist. So that is very critical to highlight the durability, performance, and impermeability of this product. Now you might ask, well, okay, that's great in an uncracked form, but what about when the material cracks? Well, that's where these microfibers come in. They are able to bridge this crack and hold it to very, very tight widths so that the water and the salts can't actually even penetrate those cracks either. So you get very good long-term performance even in a cracked condition. So why are we talking about overlays? Of course, bridge deck damage is a huge concern, especially up in the Northeast where we do a lot of salting of our roadways, and you see a lot of patchwork like shown in this photo here. Some typical deterioration mechanisms, you're all familiar, cracking, whether it's due to loading or shrinkage cracking, spalling due primarily to freeze-thaw or carbonation effects, and corrosion, which we just heard very much about with the potential to use galvanized rebar to help you protect against that. So these are all mechanisms that really kill our concrete earlier than we would hope for. Now, if your bridge deck gets bad enough, you're kind of forced into a deck replacement situation. And this is where UHPC has kind of gained its momentum, and it's this idea of using it to join prefabricated elements together on site. It bonds very well to precast. You can develop the rebar in an extremely short distance. So this has really been a big driving application, again, up in the Northeast where there's high traffic density. They're trying to do rehab faster and with a more durable solution. So the Federal Highway has been a great asset. They've done a lot of research in their facility, and they've been pushing UHPC for connections for several years now. And there's some great publications available for you as a designer if you're trying to design a connection using UHPC. But the takeaway there at the bottom is your embedment needs to be about 8 dB. So you do the math of a number 5 bar, and that's 5 inches of embedment that you need to fully develop that bar if it's in UHPC. So that's a very, very short distance. And this is the same with lap splices. Lap splices, you need about 3/4 of that distance to fully develop that lap transfer of load. So you can do really interesting things in very short distances. The one on the right is an adjacent box beam. We're finding we can use UHPC to connect these structures as well. And you don't need transverse post-tensioning. You don't need a cast-in-place deck on top, which of course is an extra step and an extra time crunch when you're designing these projects. And this will come into play in a case example I'll talk about in a minute here. So Ductile is a brand of UHPC. We have various product lines. The two on the left are primarily what we use for these connections that I talked about. The product on the right is our overlay mix. And what makes this material a little different is it has a thixotropic behavior. And for those that don't know what that is, it's basically that when you're mixing this material and inputting energy into it, it flows like a self-consolidating material would flow. But the second you remove that external energy, it stabilizes. So think about a liquid like honey. It has a very similar characteristic. So what we can do is we can take this material and place it and pour it on a slope of up to 7 to 10% and still retain that stability without it wanting to flow down to the low end of the bridge. Now, our other mixes that we use for connections is generally a self-leveling mix, so you'd have issues doing that on a bridge deck, but this mix is a little bit different. So to talk about the overlay concept, you know, we have a lot of structures out there where the existing concrete deck is not in great condition, the surface level is contaminated, and we need to do something to preserve and rehabilitate these structures. And the key really is to get at these bridges before they reach the point where they're kind of past the point of no return. Once we have to do a full deck replacement, it's a huge cost, it's a huge time constraint, and it's a nuisance to traveling public. So the idea here is to identify decks early, get in there, remove the contaminated area, and replace it with a thin bonded layer of this impermeable material. So the nice thing about UHPC is it bonds very, very well to a substrate, providing you do proper surface prep. And that's really just a roughened surface and some pre-wetting. So the two cases I'll talk about here, we have a thin layer just to try to add durability. But if you're actually wanting to add additional strength to your system through this composite action, you can beef up that layer and add supplemental rebar inside of there. And again, you don't need much cover to protect this added rebar or even your existing rebar if you need to go deeper than you would hope for. So there is a Swiss guide that's out there that you could use to design these systems to determine what kind of structural strength you can add to your system. I'm not really going to go into detail on this, but it's just going back to fundamentals, understanding where your compressive zones are, where your tension zones are, and calculating your moment capacities based on that. Now, in tension, this material is very unique. You know, if I took a sample of this and pulled it in direct tension, which would be very unique for most concrete, The material would crack like all concrete. The fibers that you see in the top right photo there would engage and would sustain that load. And so you can actually design this stuff to have a strain hardening type behavior similar to steel. And again, I'm not gonna go into too much detail there, but it helps with crack control and it helps to add some tensile capacity to your structure if you're looking to improve on that. Now, the Federal Highway has also recognized this application as a good potential to improve the durability of our system. So they do have a few publications out there. The middle document is some testing they did on a bridge that I'm about to talk about here in a minute. But the document on the left gives a nice overview about UHPC for bridge decks. So far today on the left, we've done about 235 projects with UHPC. A lot of these have been the connections that I mentioned beforehand. And on the right is how many UHPC overlays we've done in the state so far. So it hasn't been too many. We only have two projects that have been completed to date. We do have a third one in the pipeline in Iowa coming up in a few months. And we're also hearing about a few other states looking into doing one as a pilot project in their regions relatively soon. So the project in Iowa was an existing three-span bridge. It had seen a bit of deterioration over its life, built in 1967. And you can get a view of what this bridge looks like. It's kind of in the middle of nowhere. It's nothing glamorous by any means. It's kind of a small structure. But the Iowa DOT, in conjunction with FHWA, determined this was a good bridge to try this technology on. Now, it doesn't see a lot of traffic volume, but the traffic it does see is consisted of very heavy trucks that use this pathway. So they knew that they would get some good loading on this structure. So it was an existing slab beam bridge. They were going to come in and do a little bit of a scarification and replace with UHPC overlay to a 1.5-inch thickness, as shown here. Now, before they even started working on the bridge, we did have the contractor do a mock-up about 30 days ahead of schedule. And this was just to show the contractor that this material does behave a little bit different and to let them know what they're getting into before they actually start working on the bridge itself. So here's the bridge as it's surface prepared. They opted to do this in a two-stage application. And you can see their screed machine that they have set up there prior to starting the UHPC pour. In the foreground there, you can see a little bit of heavier deterioration in the left-hand corner there, and some additional rebar welded wire mesh that they used over the intermediate piers on just one half of the structure. Ultimately, they were trying to compare how does that perform against a section that didn't have that. And ultimately, I think they didn't see too much difference between the two. So the surface prep really is key. You have to have some kind of roughness for UHPC to bond to, and it can be as simple as doing a light mill on the surface of your deck. Saturating the surface is also very critical. Because UHPC has very little water, we don't want to put it on a dry surface because it'll suck a lot of the moisture out of the UHPC and your bond will be sacrificed because of that. So some study that's been done by Iowa State University, they found that about a 3-millimeter roughness is pretty much sufficient to generate adequate bond between the UHPC and the existing concrete. So that's what they targeted on this project. Now the material, it's shipped in a pre-packaged form. All the dry ingredients, these fine particles, are pre-blended in a facility, packaged, and then shipped to the job site. And then it's actually mixed in some portable high shear mixers that are brought to the site. So you can see them loading on the right-hand side one of these bulk bags into the mixer here. We do a QC test on site. It's nothing very fancy. We just kind of plop some of the material into this little plywood form, and we take off the side and see if it holds its shape. And they'll actually take that piece of wood and they'll lift it up at an angle to make sure that it doesn't, you know, flow down and it, like it would on a bridge slope. So here they are on the left placing the material. They have these nice motorized buggies that they'll take from the mixer after the material is done mixing. They'll bring it to their bridge. They'll pour it in front of the screed. And then the guys on the right-hand side, they'll just use a raking action to try to smooth out the material in front of the screed to get a nicer finish. And then a curing compound is placed at the left-hand side there. So this is the end of the first phase, and all you need to do after that, after you put the curing compound on, is cover it with plastic. Again, it has low water content, so we don't want it to dry out. You might see some surface cracking if you let it. So we cover it with plastic tarp as soon as possible. So this is after both stages have been completed. They were done in about 3 days apart, 4 days apart there. Now the surface finish isn't beautiful on this project. The screed they used wasn't really designed for UHPC. And the project was a little bit rushed due to it being a pilot program. But they came through and they actually did a milling to get a nice profile finish. So they had a diamond grinding machine with some nice blades on it, and they came through and took off about a quarter of an inch off the surface to get a nicer finish profile there. So after that, you're left with about an inch and a half thickness, which is what they were targeting. And you can see the finished surface on the right-hand side. Well, then they actually came through and they did a grooving after they did the milling process. So they used the same machine. It was a second pass that they did, and it took about a quarter of an inch groove down into there for water drainage. So here's a photo. On the right, you can see the finished grooved surface. On the left, you can see the milled surface. You can see some light spots here. Because of the screed that they were using, it wasn't really great for this project, so we had a few low spots that the milling didn't quite get very well. But ultimately, it's just a kind of a surface aesthetic issue more than anything. So a year later, we come back, we look at it, and you can see a little bit of an orangish hue to this. So when we did the milling process, some of those fibers, the steel fibers that are in there, got exposed, and those surface fibers do corrode over time. But what we found is after about a year, a lot of that surface fiber breaks away, and you're left with a deck with minimal fiber protrusion. You do have a little bit of a discoloration, but it's just an aesthetic issue on these projects. And so here's the completed bridge. A few stats, it's about 2,800 square feet of bridge deck. We use about 16 cubic yards of UHPC to complete the overlay. And we were able to increase the positive moment capacity because of that composite bond by 16% and the negative moment by about 33%. So one more case example is a project we completed last year in Delaware. So this actually wasn't an existing bridge. It was a brand new superstructure that they were replacing. And what they opted to do was this adjacent box beam system. And the goal here was to use UHPC to connect the boxes together and then to overlay the whole system with a thin layer of UHPC. So if I zoom in on the section here, the items in orange was a self-leveling UHPC that we typically use for our connections to join the boxes together. They also put an end cap on the end of the beam to act as an end diaphragm and to seal the ends of the beams to protect those pre-stressing strand ends. And then they came back and did a layer of UHPC on the surface to protect the surface of the deck, which we believe will last for the life of this structure. So here's a detail of that joint. The reinforcing lapping is very simple. You have about a 5-inch lap. It's a non-contact detail. So it's very simple to place these boxes and to fill up this void space with the UHPC. So here's a photo on the left of the voided joints, and on the right they're placing those end diaphragms, and eventually we'll place the joints in between these boxes as well. So again, we asked the contractor, a new contractor out in Delaware, to do a mock-up assembly. The screed you see on the right was a little better quality than the one we used in Iowa. And after the mock-up, we were able to talk to them about maybe a few tweaks and improvements they could do to that screed to get an even better finish. So just to show you what the mock-up kind of looked like and how the material behaves as it's flowing out of the buggy here. So it's got a little bit of cohesion to it, a little bit of tackiness to it. It's not like an elastomeric concrete per se, but it does have silica fume inside of it, which tends to give concrete a little bit of a stickiness. It's very workable in its fresh state. The guys are just trying to smooth it out to make it easier on the screed to power through the material. So before they cast the material, you need to roughen surface again. You need to pre-wet it, just like we talked about on the last job. We have mixers on site. Here we use two mixers. Each could mix about 2/3 of a cubic yard per batch, and we can do about 2 to 3 batches per hour. So that gives us a rough output of about 4 cubic yards per hour using this type of an approach. And again, another little video showing them placing it on the bridge. So then the guys, again, they push it around with their rakes. They let the screed come over it, and then they put a curing compound on to help retain the moisture on the surface until they can get the plastic tarp on top. This project was, the bridge was 50 feet long. It was very well attended by, I think, every DOT staff that was there. We had about 4 guys from FHWA there. Me and 2 other guys from our team were there. So everyone wanted to make sure the project went well. It was a new, very innovative solution, so everyone wanted to have a little bit of a piece of it. So we cure it under the tarp for a few days and come back, and they would do the next phase shortly after that. And I was out there back in February, took a few photos, and again, you see a little bit of that discoloration, but the surface finish actually is really nice. You can't see any cracking on this bridge whatsoever. And like I said, we believe it'll last for the life of the structure. So a few stats on this one. Again, about 2,000 square feet of bridge. It's not a very big project. 8 cubic yards were used for the joints and the back wall of the beams, and then about 10 cubic yards for the overlay itself. The bid price, this is what's going to scare everyone, I think. On this project, we calculated it was about $44 per square foot to do the overlay. It's a hefty price, and I think part of that was the contractor had never done this before. We had them have to do a mock-up and a few things that we had to roll into this. So, plus, it was a very small project, and whenever your quantity is smaller, you end up with a relatively higher unit price. But I think if you start looking at this from a future standpoint, this is really a set-it-and-forget-it approach. You know, you built a brand new superstructure, and now you want to protect that superstructure so that it can last its 50, 75-year design life that you intended without having to go back out there and put an overlay or replace the existing deck. So I think when you start looking at it in that retrospect, the cost starts to make a little bit more sense. Now, Europe does it a little differently, and I'm going to turn it over to my colleague, Gil, here to chat a little bit about what they've done over there.
Gilbert Brindley is a PE, is director of UHP Solutions.
Thank you. We do have a couple of different versions of overlay applications. Typically in Europe, they prefer to drive on asphalt for rideability and for noise. So they do overlay their concrete decks with asphalt. And in the U.S., we would put on the surface that you saw that Greg showed. There is some concern about that surface and the rusting, or if you are placing this in an area where there's foot traffic and you don't want those small fibers sticking out and getting in somebody's foot, you can actually do a second layer of UHPC with a much lower fiber content. You'd have to prep the surface of the first layer of UHPC and then put that second layer on. I'm gonna talk about a project here. We don't have much experience in the US with only 2 small bridges being done, one in Iowa, one in Delaware. So this use of UHPC for deck overlays has been used in Europe for a few years. A very large project was done in Switzerland by Wallow. It was a twin viaduct along Lake Geneva, and a pretty significant structure. They had several problems with it. It was a precast, pre-stressed segmental construction, built originally in the 60s, and they started to have problems with alkaline aggregate reactivity. They had spalling going on the underside of the segments. They had deck issues. They also had problems with truck capacity. So between 1960s and 2011, trucks had changed. They were much heavier. So they had an interest in both increasing the capacity of the structure and doing all the concrete repairs. What they came up with was this option of putting on a UHPC overlay instead. So Wallow had originally won this job for concrete rehabilitation and external reinforcement, and they went back in with a value engineering proposal to put on a UHPC overlay. They decided on putting a structural overlay, which included rebar in it. It was about a 1.5 inch to 2 inch depth of overlay. I'm going to show you some video that's going to demonstrate how it went in. Basically, this thing strengthened the deck by about 40%, strengthened the capacity by 40%, waterproofed the slab, protected that concrete for the future. Greg has already covered all the cool stuff about UHPC. I get to talk about the sequence of construction. They were able to do this project. Each of the two 1.3 mile long bridges were done in about 30 days. So that's taking off the asphalt layer, removing the concrete that you need to remove by hydro demolition, putting on the rebar and the UHPC overlay, and then repaving in 30 days. They started with closing either the outside or inside lane, maintaining two lanes of traffic, and using scaffolding to start the repairs underneath. They just used a regular grout or an AAR-resistant grout. They did not use UHPC on the underside. And then they went and closed one of the structures, bi-directional traffic, and they put the UHPC down. They used a proprietary paving machine that they developed for this, which distributes the UHPC onto the deck, spreads it, and finishes it. This is just some schematics on how they did it. They started with handling the curb lines first, and then they went back and did the two paved lanes in two separate sweeps. It went a little bit quick, but you could see the rebar there. The video will show this a little bit more detail. Now, when you use UHPC and you have adjacent lanes that you're doing, there is a detail for the construction joint. It's an offset joint with some rebar to help hold that thing together. Once they place the UHPC, they put down a viscreen or a plastic on top of it to keep it from having any surface cracking. This was also a high wind area, so they needed to get that covered quick so it didn't dry out. In total, they did about almost 600,000 square feet of UHPC overlay, 3,200 cubic yards. They used ductile as a product. And they did it in two successive summers, 30 days of closure. They also developed an on-site batching plant. UHPC is a particular material. You can't batch it in a central plant. It has to be batched right on site. They had a pretty large quantity they needed, so they developed their own plant to mix it. It's a high energy mix that you need to do, a lot higher than regular concrete, but that helped out this project tremendously.
Vehicles made it clear that the slabs of the viaducts had to be reinforced to ensure long already been renewed. Thus, the available road construction height was clearly limited. Here, Vallo total 630 tons of reinforcing steel were used. The ultra-high performance fiber reinforced concrete was built in with the help of machines. For this particular project, very quickly. Even though the material is extremely sticky, the large number of individually controllable discharge flaps of the special concrete spreader allows for perfect paving and the ensuing surface treatment within a very short time span. The special concrete is very expensive. For the whole surface area, any additional centimeter of road cover would have cost an extra 1 million Swiss francs. That is why the paved cover measures exactly 4 centimeters, just as required. 3 built-in sensors constantly monitored the position and working height of the finishing machine and adjusted it whenever necessary. 1 cubic meter of special concrete contains approximately 250 kilograms of brass-coated steel fiber, 3 centimeters in length. Its tensile strength that of regular concrete. Therefore, with only 4 centimeters in height, the road cover gives the viaduct the required additional strength. Mixing unit developed by Vallo and SBM. The fiber-reinforced concrete had to be mixed approximately 3 times longer than regular concrete. However, the plant reliably delivered a substantial 18 cubic meter output per hour. All components and aggregates for the fiber-reinforced concrete were delivered directly to the construction site by the Lafarge company. The on-site mixing unit shortened the transport to the exact place where the rapidly setting concrete was built in. A decisive feature was the concrete's texture. It must be spread well, but must not start to run on the surface that is inclining up to 7%. The team was extremely concentrated on this job. It was a first time ever to apply ultra-high performance fiber reinforced concrete with machine technology under such conditions. Prevent cracks from rapid drying. After the hardening process, the fiber-reinforced concrete was roughened with high-pressure water blasting to allow for better bonding with the next layer. Moved by means of hydrodynamics, applying water pressure at more than 2,000 bar. AAR-resistant grout was introduced to the stripped areas. The mobile Valo, taking it a step ahead.
I apologize for some of the audio on there. We had to condense an 8-minute video into 3 minutes, but the shirtless guy still made it through in that one. So this is basically what we're talking about. These are structures that have problems. They could be vertical surfaces, like down in a splash zone adjacent to traffic, or obviously up on the deck, on the parapets, on curbs, and those can all be coated and repaired and rehabilitated with UHPC. When we look at it for a deck, we always talk about making sure we take that material up. We don't want, particularly over in the shoulders, we don't want to leave a joint there that salts and chlorides and de-icing materials can get around the UHPC and get down to that concrete layer. Greg talked about the coverage and how this is resistant to chlorides. If you seal the deck like this, that's what you're doing. That's the work that you're doing to protect it from future degradation, from future corrosion. If there is corrosion already in the deck, it's going to stop it from continuing. Of course, you're not going to want to place this on a deck that isn't sound. Greg also showed a box beam. This is a rehabilitation for a box beam structure. Box beams typically have problems where the joints between the box beams, that joint can translate cracking up into your surface. So you can put a UHPC overlay and also take out some material right over the joints and basically bond those together, and you won't have that problem with the cracking coming up.
So just to close, we're running a little over here, but one last example, because we're in Florida. Florida did a project, I think a couple of years ago, or 2016, where they had an adjacent voided slab system. They had reflective cracking, their transverse post-tensioning was giving out on them, and so they were actually able to dig out the existing shear keys and replace it with a UHPC connection rather than having to remove the entire superstructure or do a cast-in-place deck to try to tie everything back in. So another way you can rehabilitate existing structures. I just want to touch on costs briefly. You know, we talked about that $44 per square foot, which makes everyone want to run for the hills. I understand that. But I think as the innovation becomes more mainstream and we start looking at maybe larger projects and particularly reducing that thickness, you know, we did those first projects at 1.5 inch thick, and we can really bring that down to about an inch thick, which is going to help shave off some of that cost. So we're thinking for future projects, maybe we'll fall in the $25 to $40 per square foot range, depending on material thickness and project size. Now I know that is still more expensive than a lot of the overlay options out there, but again, we're doing this as a final step to maintain this bridge for the life of the structure. If you want to learn more about the actual testing of some of these overlay projects, Zach Haber with FHWA is going to be giving a talk during the C6 session. So I encourage you to tune into that. He's going to go over some of the literature they've put together, talk about the bonding of UHPC to the substrate, and some of the performance that they're seeing out of this system. And I just want a quick plug. You know, UHPC can do a lot of other things. It's not just overlays. It's not just connections. We're using it for joint headers to reinforce expansion joint areas. We're even using it for link slabs to eliminate these joints entirely. And of course, pier jackets is another common application to help improve the durability of your substructure.
In New Hampshire, we know that membranes we use membranes a lot, and we find that if they fail, they end up trapping water. So I was just curious with the high impermeability of the UHPC, why on that big project in Europe they decided to do an overlay, and were they concerned about failures that would end up trapping water?
My understanding is they weren't concerned about the product at all. It's just that that's the way that they do things over there. They really prefer to use asphalt. It's kind of amazing because we look at asphalt in the Northeast, and you know it's just a series of potholes. And the Swiss have another way of doing things, and they're able to maintain their asphalt surfaces in a very serviceable condition. They come over here and drive on our roads, and they're shocked that we actually drive on roads that are that, you know, uncomfortable.
Is a quality control and a quality acceptance plan when you're on site, when you're placing that, what's the general QAQC plan for when you're batching out there or something?
Yeah, so for our joint projects, it's a little different. We have a self-leveling mix, so we do a flow test, and we look at what the diameter of the flow is, and we make sure the fibers aren't sinking to the bottom of the mix. We regulate the temperature of the mix, make sure we're not too high or too low, and we have procedures out there that we can use to tweak the quality control as they're placing it. Now, we always have, from a ductile standpoint, a rep on site to oversee all the mixing and batching procedures to make sure that everything's being done right. The last thing you want is for this stuff to get installed improperly, because it is an expensive product, and if you do it wrong, you're going to regret it. So we want to make sure it's done right, and so we have a guy out there to help oversee the operation there.
How about supplies? Is it only ductile supplying this material yet? Anybody else? I mean, we have a salt source problem in the United States, or?
Right, yeah. So I was encouraged yesterday during the plenary session to hear that the government is rethinking their stance on proprietary products, because we do kind of fall into that niche. Right now in the U.S., we are really the main supplier of UHPC, but there are quite a few DOTs that are dabbling in generating their own local mix. Some are having decent success with it. Some are still trying to find that path. In Canada, we do have a direct commercial supplier for competition. But so far, we have been kind of the main supplier. And what comes with that is 10 years of really sound experience that we can bring to these projects to help make sure it's a success. There we go.
The preceding was produced by the National Center for Pavement Preservation. More information can be found on the web at pavementpreservation.org. Additional support provided by Michigan State University.